All right. Hello, everybody. Good morning and welcome to the Fayetteville Public Library to our Super Saturday program. I'm Miss Gina. I work here in the Youth Services Department, and we're really excited about today's Super Saturday. But before we begin, I just want to let you know that we do have Super Saturday programs every Saturday at 10 o'clock. Most of them are here in the Event Center. Next week, we're going to be welcoming Barnyard Buddies, and that will actually be outside because we'll have lots of fun things to pet and look at, like goats and some other animals. We also are in the midst of our Summer Reading Club program. If you haven't already registered, you can still register for that. You'll do that. You can find information online if you'd like on our website at faylib.org, but you can also just download the Read Squared app. Log in by finding the Fayetteville Public Library and then start tracking your reading. Kids and adults can join the program and you can earn prizes along the way and you can be entered to win our drawings. The main drawings for the kids program, there's a bike, there's a Kindle Fire. For the teens, we have an altitude jump party. There's lots of great things. You have until July 31st to log all your reading so that you can enter the prizes. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over the time to our presenter today, Dr. J.D. Willson from the University of Arkansas Department of Biology, and he's going to tell us why we should love snakes. I know I do.
All right, thank you. All right, welcome everybody. Thanks for coming out on a beautiful Saturday morning. My name's J.D. Willson. I'm a professor in biology here at the university. I study ecology and conservation biology, but my specialty is herpetology, so I study creepy crawly critters, and I'm here today to talk to you a little bit about some of the species, especially the ones that we have here around Fayetteville. These are a lot of times animals that people don't even realize we have right in our own neighborhoods. I find them fascinating and unusual and interesting, so I'm going to share some of that with you today. Couple of sort of housekeeping issues before we get going. I will ask that everybody please stay seated, especially these little ones over here, which includes my daughter, who's going to be my helper along the way. Please stay seated for now. I may ask some questions. If you think you know an answer, raise your hand. Please answer the question. I would love to hear your snake stories, but we can do that afterwards. Don't just yell out your answer. And especially stay seated. We're not going to touch animals for now. If everybody's good and stay seated during the talk, we'll have a little show and tell session at the end where everybody can get up and maybe get to hold or touch a snake. But for now, please stay in your seat. Raise your hand if you have a question. And hopefully you'll learn something interesting that you've never known before. All right, so I said my specialty is herpetology, right? That means I study reptiles and amphibians. When I talk about amphibians, who knows what kind of animals I'm talking about? Who knows? Do you know? What kind of animals?
Snakes.
Snakes. We're talking about amphibians. Snakes are not amphibians. Do you know an amphibian? Frogs. That's a good one.
Newts.
Newts and salamanders. So those are our two major groups of amphibians that we have here. We have frogs and toads. And salamanders, which includes newts. There's another major group that's found in rainforests and tropical areas called a Sicilian. If you have some time, Google it. They're totally weird and bizarre, but I don't have any Sicilians for you, and we won't see them here. So I'm gonna stick to frogs and toads today. Let's get started and jump right into things. Let's talk about a salamander. So this is a salamander. It's an amphibian. This is one of our more common local species. It's called a spotted salamander.
Yes.
Most people don't realize that we're actually really lucky in Arkansas to have incredible diversity of salamanders. In fact, I personally think that if we should be proud of any of our wildlife, salamanders are really our claim to fame. Most parts of the world have very few salamanders. We have 30 to 40 species of salamanders in Arkansas. In fact, there are places here around Fayetteville where you can go to one stream and find six or seven different kinds of salamanders in one stream. These are animals that most people have never seen. That's because they spend most of their life hidden underground. So the name amphibian basically means that They have two parts to their lives. They live part of their life in the water and part of their life on land. And these are basically, these were some of the first animals that evolved from fish way back before the dinosaurs. And in many ways, they're still very much like fish. They lay eggs that have sort of a jelly coat in the water. They have an aquatic larval stage that you're probably familiar with, frog tadpoles. A larval salamander looks very much like a frog tadpole, except that they're carnivorous. They eat bugs and mosquito larvae and things like that. They live for a while in the water, anywhere from a few weeks to a year or more. And then they undergo what we call metamorphosis, which is where they grow limbs, lose their gills, come up on land, and most of them go live on land for the rest of their life. So these salamanders, most of their life, they live up in the woods under logs and down in burrows underground. And then once a year, they all come out to lay their eggs and breed. And in fact, the best way to see these is to know exactly where and when to go. These breed during the first big heavy rains we have in the spring. So like when you get big thunderstorms in March, these come out of the woodwork. And if you're out there on the right night, you can see hundreds of these in one pond. All the males do little dances, the females lay eggs, and then in the matter of a week or two, they're gone and you don't see them again for the whole rest of the year. So one reason we study these salamanders is because they're some of the species that are sort of most threatened in terms of conservation. And one of the major problems for these salamanders is that they're losing the places that they need to breed. So the ponds or wetlands that they breed in. What do you think is the most important thing for a salamander in terms of the pond where it's going to lay its eggs and raise its larvae? What's the most important characteristic of that pond that's going to determine whether it's a good salamander pond or a bad salamander pond? Raise your hand if you think you know. Any kids know? Do you know? Water? Yeah, so it needs water. It's important. What do you know? How pure the water is? That's important. Yeah, they're, you know, water quality, things like pollution and things can be very bad for them. There are some species we study, especially the ones that live in streams, that are sort of sensitive to pollution. For these guys, pollution's not the biggest deal. It's mostly something else. Do you know? Mud and rocks are important. What's really important is not necessarily what is there, but what's not there. So what needs to not be in the pond for these to be happy? Who said it? Over here. Fish, right? So one bass or one bluegill will eat up every little baby salamander that gets laid in that pond. So when we think of ponds in terms of salamanders, a good salamander pond is a pond that doesn't have any fish. That usually means it dries up in the summertime. So the places that these really like are places like ditches, roadside ditches, small wetlands that have lots of vegetation that dry up in the summer. Unfortunately, when people come along, if you have a ditch or a wet spot or a swamp on your property, what do we do with it? We usually fill it in or we dig it out and put fish in it so we can go fishing or swimming, right? Either of those, you do either of those and these guys disappear, right? So these are having trouble in a lot of places. We're lucky to still have these pretty commonly around Fayetteville. We have actually several different species that are related to this one, including one cool one that's called a ring salamander that's only found in the Ozark Mountain region. Actually, when I have colleagues come from overseas, when I have, you know, my Australian Steve Irwin colleagues come and visit, they could care less about rattlesnakes and copperheads. They all want to see ring salamanders because there's no salamanders in Australia. There's only one or two in Africa and Europe. In parts of North America, parts of the Appalachians, there might be 20 species of salamanders on one little mountaintop. So really neat animals. Really high diversity. Let's move on and talk about frogs and toads. So frogs and toads are in a group that the sort of scientific name we use for them is called the anurans, A-N-U-R-A-N, anuran. Anybody know your Latin, know what that stands for, what that means? Any adults know? Anuran means no tail, right? So these are our amphibians with no tail. Salamanders are our tailed amphibians. These are our tailless amphibians, right? So the anurans include the frogs and the toads. Who thinks that this is a frog? Raise your hand. Who thinks that this is a toad? Raise your hand. Okay, good answer. You're all right, because that's kind of a trick question. We have some species that we call frogs. We have some species we call toads. That's not really a good scientific term. We usually use the term frog to mean an anuran that's more aquatic and lives around water. We usually use the term toad to refer to one that lives on land and has drier, wartier skin. This is a really neat one. It's one of our rarest frogs in the country. It's called a crawfish frog, and it's sort of halfway between what we would normally call a frog and normally call a toad. It's related to our sort of typical frogs, like a bullfrog or a leopard frog, but it acts much more like a toad. It has sort of short, stubby legs, bumpy skin, and actually this guy spends very little time in a pond. The unique thing about these frogs is that these are prairie frogs. So if you don't know, read a little bit about Fayetteville Natural Heritage, or the natural heritage of this area. We used to have prairies all across Northwest Arkansas. And these frogs lived out in those prairies. And in the middle of the summer, these lived out in the middle of a grassy field in the baking 100 degree heat all summer long. Anybody have an idea how they do that? How do they survive in a baking hot cattle pasture or hay field all summer long? If you've ever seen a crawfish burrow, so you've probably seen they make little mud chimneys in your yard in the spring when it's muddy. These are called crawfish frogs because in the summertime, they live down a burrow of a crawfish. So those crawfish dig a hole way down. They dig all the way down until they hit water, and there'll be a pool of water at the bottom of that burrow. Even when it's 110 degrees outside, that burrow could be 5 feet deep with a nice pool of water at the bottom, and these frogs live in those burrows all summer long. The problem, of course, is you drive a plow across that land, you bury all those burrows, and both the frogs and the crayfish are gone. And unfortunately, we're still lucky to have these around Northwest Arkansas. Most of the populations around Fayetteville, unfortunately, are gone. Just in the last 20 years, we've lost like 15 to 20 populations of these just right around Fayetteville. But actually, the Arkansas populations are doing better than most places. This species is pretty much gone from Louisiana and Iowa. They're listed as a conservation concern species in every state where they occur. And this is one that my students and I do a lot of research on to try to conserve and preserve in our area. Really neat little frog, and again, sort of halfway between what we would typically call a frog and a toad. All right, this is a little tiny guy. Hopefully you can get a look at this. Maybe the projector can zoom way in. I don't know how good their zoom is, but this is a tiny little guy. Oh my God. So we have big, huge frogs like bullfrogs. We have little, teeny, tiny frogs like these. This is one of our tree frogs. So we have a couple of different species that are broadly called tree frogs. And they don't get a whole lot bigger than this. They get a little bigger, but not much bigger than like my thumb, say. And the neat thing about tree frogs, we'll see if this guy can do it, is that they have neat little suction cups on their feet, and so they can hang completely upside down. There we go. They're really good jumpers, they're really good climbers, they have suction cups on their feet. Anybody seen one of these before? Raise your hand if you've seen one of these before. Where'd you see it?
In my backyard. I really like to see it.
In your backyard? Where in your backyard?
There's this muddy corner.
Uh-huh.
With sticks that they usually
sit on.
Sit on
them?
So,
these guys, they're really common around here. You hear them singing in the summertime. They make a sound that's like, you hear it when you get a thunderstorm in the afternoon, you'll hear these calling. They have really good camouflage. You imagine this guy sits up on the bark of a tree or something and he just completely disappears. The best way to see these is to go out on a nice, warm, humid summer night and look around your back lights on your back porch, because they learn that the bugs come to those lights, and at night they'll come out and eat the bugs from around those lights. Really neat little frogs. We have several species of tree frogs in Arkansas. This one's called a gray tree frog, which is our most common one around here. All right, I've got one more, and this is one of the only a couple of ones I'm going to show you that's not one that you could find around here. This is one that's not native to Arkansas, but it's impressive, and there's a good story to tell, so we'll see. Let's see if I can get them out here. All right. So here's a little bit different scale of frog. So is this a frog or a toad? Who thinks it's a frog? Who thinks it's a toad? Yeah, so this is a very typical toad. This is called a cane toad or a marine toad. It's really big, obviously, but he's got warty, dry skin. He's got sort of short, stumpy legs. This guy lives on land most of the time. He also pees a lot. Sorry, it's just water. So these guys live on land most of the time. They have this dry, bumpy skin. You'll hear people talk about them having warts. These are not warts. They're just bumps on their skin. And in fact, some of these bumps, if you can see, they have really a couple of really big ones on the front. These are actually poison glands that make poison. So when he's scared, he can ooze out a little bit of poison. Who knows the difference between something that's poisonous and something that's venomous? What's the difference? Anybody else? Do you know?
Poison is when you consume something and it messes with your digestive system.
That's exactly right. So, poisonous things are dangerous if you bite them. This guy's just peeing all over the place. Are dangerous if you bite them. Venomous things are dangerous if they bite you, right? So this guy's poisonous. He could bite me all day long and I'd be in no trouble, but if I tried to chew on him or if a dog grabbed him and tried to chew on him, you'd get a really bad taste in your mouth. You might even get sick. It's not, his poison is not gonna kill you, I don't think, but that's the difference between a venom and a poison. A lot of amphibians, especially toads, have pretty potent poisons. The reason I have this guy, other than that he's really big and spectacular, this is one of the biggest toads on Earth. They get even quite a bit bigger than this. The reason I have this is it's a good example of an invasive species. So these toads are native to South America and Mexico. They actually get up in their native range into South Texas, but they've been introduced all over the world, and they're a real problem in places like Hawaii and Australia, much of the Caribbean, Florida. In many of these places, they were introduced on purpose to control insects, and they just went crazy. And now they're overpopulated, and they pose threats to lots of native animals. Really impressive animal, one of our biggest inurns, I should say. What else can I say about these guys? You can see he's sort of jumping a little bit. He's making a croaking noise. When they make, all these frogs communicate a lot vocally, so they'll have vocal sacs either under their mouth or on the sides of their head. Right now, he's just making a noise that says, "Let go of me, I'm not your mate, don't mate with me," because he thinks I'm trying to grab him to mate with him right now. All right, so those are some amphibians. Let's talk about the other half of the animals I work on, which are the reptiles. So who knows what kind of animals I'm talking about when I talk about reptiles? Snakes, that's a good one. What else? Turtles, what else? Cold-blooded animals, that's right. What other specific kinds? Crocodiles and alligators. Anybody know the last one? You know? Lizards, good job. Okay, we got all the major ones. There's a couple other weird ones that don't really fit in normal categories, but we got the big ones. Where's my box here? Here we go. So here's one that is not the one I'm looking for. Here's one of the most common reptiles you might see around your yard here. Anybody seen one of these before? Yeah, like this. This is called a skink, and it's a lizard, right? This looks an awful lot like the salamander that I showed you before, right? Its body form is very similar. It's got kind of a long body with short legs and a long tail. It looks kind of shiny, but these are actually totally different from salamanders, right? This guy's much more closely related to an alligator or even a bird than he is to that salamander that I showed you before. Reptiles are different from amphibians because they have scales on their body. So if I touch him, he's dry and sort of shiny and smooth. He's not sticky and slimy like an amphibian. They also lay eggs with shells on land. So he lays, well, she lays little eggs that look a very lot like a chicken egg, just little teeny tiny ones. And that lets them live on land. They are ectothermic, which is our fancy way of saying cold-blooded. I don't like the term cold-blooded. We don't use that much because it gives the impression that these animals are sort of slow and cold and it has a negative connotation. And in actuality, this lizard, he wants to be 90 degrees, and he's 90 degrees most of the time. The difference is that he stays 90 degrees not by burning his own metabolism in his body, but by moving in and out of the sun and the shade to stay the right temperature. So if you've seen these love hot, dry spots like rock walls, driveways, patios, places like that. You'll see these all summer long running around on your patio. Those salamanders, this time of year when it's hot, those are 3 feet underground trying to stay as cool and wet as possible. So even though they look kind of similar, they're very different biology. This is a very typical reptile. That's a very typical amphibian. One neat thing about these skinks, so we have several species of skinks. This is our most common one called a five-lined skink. He has five lines, or I should say she has five lines down her back. One really cool thing about these skinks is they're one of the few lizards or snakes that where the mother stays with the eggs after she lays them. So in about May or June, she laid a clutch of eggs, usually under a rock or a log. She curls up around it, protects them, keeps them safe. And then right about this time of year, they hatch out. And we've actually got some little teeny tiny babies that were just born last week. So these are her little teeny tiny babies. And you've probably seen these. People call them blue-tailed skinks because when they're young, they have a bright blue tail. That bright blue tail is part of their defense. So if you grab one of these, or if a cat or something, or a bird tries to grab one of these, they break off their tail, and that tail wriggles all around like a little worm. It'll wriggle for like half an hour. And the idea is the predator grabs the tail and eats the tail while the rest of the lizard gets away. And the cool thing is, these lizards can grow their tails back. So they'll break it off, and in a year or so, it'll grow back completely again. So really neat little lizards. There's sort of a folklore that these are dangerous or just sting or something. They're not. They're completely harmless. They're actually really good at eating bugs and stuff, so they're great to have around your garden or your patio. They're really fun to watch. They're very sort of animated. Really neat. Oh, hey there. All right, so those are lizards. What's coming up next? Should I get out the crocodile? No, I don't have any crocodiles. Okay, let's do turtles. We'll start with these turtles, okay. This might be the most common turtle you see around Fayetteville. If I can brush them off a little bit. So these are probably the most common turtle you see around Fayetteville, certainly in your yards and places like that. These are called box turtles, three-toed box turtles, or eastern box turtles. These are our land turtles around here. So most of our turtles live in the water. These turtles live on land. They might go sit in a puddle on a hot day in the summer, but they don't swim very well at all. And they're really not water turtles, they're land turtles. The interesting thing is these are not tortoises. They're actually not related pretty very closely to tortoises at all. These are basically related to our pond turtles. They just evolved to live a more land-based lifestyle along the way. They get their name. Maybe I'll just let this guy walk around a little bit. So they get their name because, unlike most turtles, the bottom of their shell, we call that their plastron. That's sort of the scientific name for the bottom of their shell. In most turtles, that's a hard piece of bone. In these turtles, they have a hinge down the middle, and that bends. So when they get scared, they can close up completely. All turtles can pull their heads in, but box turtles are one of the only ones that can close up completely. And that provides good protection for things like raccoons or foxes or other things that might eat them. The thing about turtles, so the turtle's sort of whole strategy to life is to have this heavily armored shell, and that gives really good protection, and they live a really long time. These turtles can live 50 years easily, probably 100 years or more. One problem with the science of turtles is that the turtles usually outlive the scientists that are trying to study them. But certainly 75 years plus, probably 100 years. This one actually is one that I got as a kid, not much older than most of you. I've had him for over 30 years, and he looks just like he does the day I got him. When they're younger, one neat thing about these box turtles is that when they're young, you can often see the rings of growth on their shell because they grow faster in the summer and barely grow at all over the winter, so it's a lot like the rings on a tree. If you look closely, you can sort of see sequential circles on the scutes of his shell. Actually, this is a good time to talk about a turtle shell in general. A turtle shell is not like a snail shell, right? It's part of their skeleton. The inside of the shell is made of bone. It's actually their ribs all fused together. And it's covered by keratin, which is basically like fingernail type material. So a turtle can't leave his shell. If a turtle, you know, he's part of his shell. You can't pull a turtle out of its shell like that. So when they're young, they grow these rings on their shell, and you can often count how old they are. So this one, I can see the middle of each scale on his shell starts with a small piece like this. I can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This guy's 5 and a half, almost 6 years old. That one's 40 years plus. By the time they get old like this, their shell gets smoothed over and sort of worn down, and they don't grow much anymore anyway. What else can I say about box turtles? If you see box turtles, we're very lucky in Arkansas to still have a lot of box turtles. Many parts of the eastern U.S., they've disappeared due to things like collection, road mortality, them getting run over is a big problem. If you see one of these crossing a road or you find one in your yard, by all means, go rescue it and put it across the street, get it out of harm's way. But the important thing is you don't want to take him far at all from where you found him. Just note which direction he's going, take him across the street on that side. Even if it looks like a spot that is a little dangerous, these turtles, you know, this is a 40-year-old turtle. They know their little home range. They don't move more than a couple hundred yards their whole life. And they know every inch of that territory. They know where to go. They know where the food is. They know where to spend the winter. And if you take him far away, he's just going to try and go right back where he came from. They can navigate pretty well. They use magnetism and things like that to navigate, much like birds do. And they'll try to get back, and usually that doesn't end well for the turtle. So if you find one of these in your yard, by all means, feed him some strawberries or something. Observe him a little bit, but you want to leave these to be. Leave them in nature. They take a very long time to grow up. They reproduce very slowly. And hopefully we can keep box turtles common in Fayetteville because they're really one of our neatest local wildlife species, I think.
What else do they like to eat?
So they're omnivores, meaning they eat kind of anything. They love fruits of any sort, so any kind of fruit, wild fruits especially, so mulberries, persimmons, strawberries, mushrooms. They love mushrooms. They love slugs and worms, bugs. They'll eat just about anything. All right, so you've probably seen a box turtle. Here's one that you might not have seen, a little bit not necessarily uncommon, but one that most people don't see. This is called a mud turtle. And this is an aquatic turtle. He lives in the water. He's like a little mini snapping turtle, but they only get about this big. This is a full-grown adult. They don't get much bigger than this. And these basically live by digging around in the mud and yuck in the bottom of sort of swampy or pond-type habitats. They don't sit up and bask on logs quite the way that some of our other pond turtles do. So unless you're a kid mucking around in the water a lot, you're probably not going to see these very often. But these are great little guys to have in your pond. They're basically the little vacuum cleaners of your pond. They go around and eat up dead stuff, aquatic insects, crayfish, things like that. They are feisty little things. The first one of these I ever caught, I put them in my pocket. And they have jaws that are built for crushing snails and crayfish and things like that. So I never did that again. But they're neat little turtles. Again, they don't get really any bigger than this. This is a good size one. All right, so that's one that you may not have seen before. Let's see one that's even weirder. Here we go. This is a really bizarre turtle. It might be my favorite local turtle. It's very strange and unturtle-like. So this is called a soft-shell turtle, a spiny soft-shell turtle. Unlike most turtles, they have skin that covers their shell, and the bone in their shell is not very thick, so it's flexible. It feels like a pancake. It's kind of leathery. They also have a really long neck, and their nose is on the front of their mouth, and they use that like a snorkel. So I just told you that the turtle's sort of whole strategy to life is to have this indestructible shell and live a really long time and be protected, right? So why would this turtle not have a hard shell? Why, over evolutionary time, would they have lost their hard shell? Why would it be advantageous to have this soft shell and not a hard shell? What do you think? Better swimming, that's right. So let's go back to our mud turtle for a second. Where's our mud turtle? Here he is. So this is a great little package if you live in a swamp, right? Imagine if this turtle tried to live in the rapids in the Buffalo River. What do you think would happen? Yeah, he'd sink like a rock, probably get washed down to the Gulf of Mexico, right? This guy is built for speed and being streamlined in the water, right? So these are basically river turtles. They also live in big lakes as well. But they're most common in our rivers and streams. And if you think turtles are slow, take a look at these guys in the water. These are some of the fastest turtles around. They are really hard to catch. They're often hard to even get a good look at. They do bask on logs and stuff occasionally, but usually they drop off and are gone long before you get very close to them. So they're actually hard to get a good look at, but they're pretty common in most of our lakes and rivers. Beaver Lake's full of them. Lake Fayetteville has plenty of these. They get quite big. Females get trash can lid size. One issue that we're concerned about with these turtles, these are one of the turtles in the state that are still pretty regularly harvested for food. People eat these, yeah? Which, you know, historically was a sustainable food source and was probably not harmful to populations. But the problem is, in the last few decades, a market for turtle meat has developed overseas, mostly in China. And luckily, it's going down now. The demand's going down. But for the last couple of decades, the entire country, but Arkansas, exported millions of these turtles over to Asia for the food market. And there are folks in the Delta who trap tens of thousands of these every year and send them overseas. So that's one real concern we have for these turtles, is that over-collection. What? For food and for medicine, both. Yeah, unfortunately, the worldwide hotspots of turtle diversity are Southeast Asia and the southeastern U.S. And unfortunately, many of the Asian species have almost completely disappeared, and so we're becoming the obvious place to come to still get turtles. We're lucky, again, in Arkansas to still have lots of turtles in many places, but they reproduce so slowly that it's very easy to over-harvest them. And that's one thing we're looking at in our research, is sort of how to regulate that harvest as best we can. All right, so those are some turtles. What do we have? Are we down to snakes? I think we're down to snakes. Okay, let's start with a snake. Just as a heads up, nothing that I have here is venomous. I wouldn't be holding them like this if they were, so you got nothing to worry about if I'm walking around with snakes. That said, this is one that a lot of people see and think is a venomous snake. So this is one of our most common aquatic snakes. So this is a northern water snake. Yeah, it's a midland water snake or northern water snake. These are one of our most common snakes. Every lake, river, and stream has at least a few of these in it. Some have lots and lots. These are harmless, but they often get mistaken for copperheads or water moccasins. So unfortunately, these get killed a lot. People get afraid of them. These are our venomous snakes too are important parts of our natural ecosystems. They're important predators of things like fish and frogs. Lots of our birds of prey love to eat these. And they're really neat animals. You know, if you're in the river, swimming or kayaking, and you see one of these, if you're 3 or 4 feet away, you're safe. They're not gonna come get you. But take a minute to look at them. They're really interesting to watch. They're very inquisitive. I've had cases where I can feed them minnows out of my hand, even a wild snake.
Can I show my grandson the lines on his mouth?
Yeah, so that's one way. I mean, we always say, the best way to learn your snakes is to do a bunch of research, get a field guide. We're lucky in Arkansas to have one of the best web pages for reptiles in the whole country. It's called Herps of Arkansas. Has great pictures, great information. One way that you can tell these from... Nope, we're not touching. Remember, everybody, we need to stay in our seats right now. If we don't stay in our seats, we won't get to touch snakes later. That means you, Cora. So one way that you can tell these from a venomous copperhead or water moccasin is that they have vertical bars on their lips. So if you look right along his lips, he's got like dark markings that go up and down. A water moccasin or a cottonmouth, which are the same thing, would have basically a white, just plain white area right along his lips. Even venomous snakes, the best thing you can possibly do is just give them space and leave them alone. They'll get out of your way. If there's one there, there's more, and so killing them really isn't going to get rid of them. And most snake bites in the U.S. come from people trying to kill snakes. You know, we always say most snake bites, if you look at the statistics, most snake bites in the U.S. are on men between 18 and 40. There's often alcohol involved. It's usually a, hey, watch this kind of situation. So all of our snakes, you give them 4 feet of space, you're plenty safe. And take a minute to watch them. They're really interesting and unusual. A couple of interesting things about these water snakes and some of the related species. You've probably heard about ways that snakes kill their prey, right? So some are venomous. They'll use venom to kill their prey. Some are constrictors that will squeeze their prey. These are neither. They just eat their prey whole and alive. So he could eat a fish this big pretty easily, and he'd just swallow it whole, right? Another neat thing about these is that unlike most reptiles, these give birth to live babies. They don't lay eggs. So right about now, the females are pregnant, and they'll give birth in August and September for the most part. Really neat snakes. In the wild, these snakes, they're not dangerous, but they definitely have a reputation for being among the sort of least friendly snakes. If you grab a wild one of these, he's going to poop all over you and probably bite you, which will be like a scratch, and not be very friendly. Herps of Arkansas. Herps of Arkansas. You can just Google like snakes of Arkansas and it'll pop. I'm sure it'll be the top hit. Okay, what do we have here? All right, so a lot of us, when we think of snakes, we think of big, scary, impressive snakes. Most of our snakes, probably more than half of our snake species in Arkansas, are not big at all, and they're not dangerous at all. This is one of my favorites, probably one of the most beautiful snakes you'll find around here. It's called a milk snake. So you may have heard of this one. This is the one that mimics the colors of a coral snake, which is a venomous species. We're lucky to not have coral snakes in northern Arkansas. Remember to stay in your seats, guys. The closest we get to coral snakes is south central Arkansas has a small population of coral snakes. But these have a color pattern that's very similar to a coral snake. You've probably heard the little rhyme, you know, red touches black, friend of Jack, or whatever it is. Red touches yellow, kill a fellow. We always say, if you have to say the rhyme, you shouldn't be messing with the snake. Because it usually is true in this area, but it's not always true. You get coral snakes that have weird patterns that are not normal. And certainly once you get out of the southeastern US, it doesn't work at all. There are coral snakes that don't follow that color pattern and non-venomous snakes that do. But this is a really neat one. This is a young one, but they only get about 2 feet long. They're beautiful color. This species is one of the more popular pet snakes in its different sort of color versions. They eat all kinds of things. The favorite thing of these little ones to eat are lizards. These are sort of lizard specialists almost. But as they get, oh, he's trying to eat my finger. Yeah, so that's a snake bite for you. He's so small, it doesn't even break the skin. He probably actually smells that skink on my hands. That's probably why he just tried to bite me. Because that was not really a defensive bite. That was like a, I'm gonna try to eat your finger kind of bite. What else can we say about milk snakes? These have one of the biggest ranges of any snake in the US. They're found from Maine to Colorado and then down to Honduras and Guatemala and even down to Panama. They look very different in different parts of the country. We have some of the prettiest ones here with this beautiful red and white and black coloration. Generally, the closer you are to where there are coral snakes, the more they look like a coral snake. If you go to Maine, these look nothing like this. They're brown and kind of blotchy and look nothing like a coral snake. So the closer you get to coral snakes, the better that pattern matches. Really kind of neat. Beautiful little snakes. Man, he really wants to eat my finger. All right, here's one that's a little more impressive. All right. So this is a species of rat snake. This is called a Great Plains rat snake. If you know your snakes at all, you may know a corn snake, which is usually a bright orange. It's one of the most common pet snakes. This is the Arkansas version of a corn snake. The orange ones come from Florida and Georgia and the Southeast. Around here, they look like this. I think they're just as pretty. They're just a little bit more subdued. But these are one of our larger species. They climb really well. They eat mostly rodents. So this is a great one to have around your barn. Or, you know, living in your garage or something. They'll take care of your mice and rats. They're actually one of the most important predators on bird nests in the forest. It's interesting, until about 10 years ago, 15 years ago, all the wildlife biologists assumed that snakes were cool, but not terribly important predators. Then all of a sudden in the last 10 years, they've been realizing that snakes are actually some of the most important predators in our forests. What do you think happened in the last 10 years that made us realize that snakes are actually much more important than we thought they were? What do you think happened? What's changed that made us understand that snakes are the most important bird nest predator in most eastern forests? Who knows? Got any hunters out here? What's the most, probably the biggest game changer in hunting in the last 10, 15 years? You know? What? Say that again. overpopulation or something? No, not overpopulation. Do you know? I can't hear you. Who knows? I'll give you a hint. It's technology. What kind of technology has changed in wildlife biology and hunting?
Hunting cameras.
Hunting cameras, right? All of a sudden, we have all these remote cameras that we can put out all over the place. People started putting remote cameras on bird nests, and they realized that all those eggs that were disappearing were snakes eating them, right? All the wildlife biologists, you know, when a mammal eats bird eggs, they leave the shells all over the place. It's very obvious. A snake just comes in, eats the whole nest, and it's gone, and they never knew what happened. So all of a sudden, when you put those cameras on bird nests, you realize that these snakes are one of the most important predators on birds in many of our systems. What else can I say about these guys? The eastern version of a corn snake gets its name because their belly looks like Indian corn, like that fall field corn. They get a little bigger than this, but this is a pretty big one. We have another one that unfortunately I don't have today that's called a black rat snake. That's the most common big black snake we have around here. They're another rodent and bird eater for the most part, and a good one to have around your property. All right, we're gonna do one more. That's one that is not from around here. Who wants to see a boa constrictor? All right. Everybody ready? Here we go. Here's our giant boa constrictor. So when I say boa constrictor, everybody's expecting me to bring out a 15-foot-long giant tropical reptile, right? This is also a boa constrictor, and this is one that lives in the U.S. Not here in Arkansas, but all on the West Coast from Southern California up into Canada. We have these little tiny boa constrictors. And they don't get much bigger than this. They only get about 2 feet long. They're called a rubber boa because they feel really neat. They almost feel like they're made of rubber. They have this stumpy tail. They actually use this tail as part of their defense. When they get scared from a predator, they curl up in a ball and they stick this stumpy tail up in the air. And the idea is the predator thinks that that's his head and bites the tail instead of the head. In fact, when you catch these in the wild, their tails are usually all scarred up and bitten from where they've fended off predators in the past. These are really neat little snakes. They're hard to find because they spend most of their time underground, but they eat rodents, mice, and shrews and things like that. And these are actually one of our most cold tolerant, despite the fact that they're a boa, they're one of the most cold tolerant and far northern ranging snakes in the country. They get all the way up into central British Columbia, Idaho, Wyoming. It's one of like three species of snakes in Yellowstone National Park. And you tell most people that there's boa constrictors in Yellowstone and they wouldn't believe you. But really neat little snakes and actually quite closely related to the big giant boa constrictors you'd see in the rainforest in South America. Okay, so this is my last snake. What we're gonna do now is if you guys would like to touch or hold a snake, what we're gonna do is we're gonna come over here and we're gonna form two different lines and we're gonna stand in line and wait your turn if you wanna touch or hold one of these snakes. So if we're good, we can have kids or others that wanna come line up over here. Yeah, that would be great. Yep.
So do you want one for each side of the table?
Yeah, actually, well, I think we can do... Cora, can you come over here? Cora? Well, we'll start with one.
You want to do one side of the table?
Yeah, that would be good.
We're gonna make one line.
You want to hold this guy? Or touch him? How are you holding snakes? Do you want to do this one?
Okay. You just tell me what I'm supposed to
do. Yeah, just be gentle.
I know a lot of snakes. Snakes. I know a lot of snakes. I know a lot of snakes. anacondas.